Hi, Sandro here. Isn't electricity just oh so convenient? It makes me wonder what might be at the other side of that line. Might it be a 120-year-old steam engine?
Of course, in reality, following the power line and finding a piston-driven steam engine on the other end is not how Switzerland's modern power grid works. It is fed by many power sources, 52.8% of the power coming from hydroelectric as in 2023.
But my actual question was whether it could be. And there the answer is yes. How can I tell? Because I saw it with my own eyes, and so can you.
This is the second of a pair of videos documenting the historical backup generator from the Gaswerk Schlieren. This machine is a fully functional steam generator, built in 1904 and now kept in perfect working condition by the Association of Volunteers TGV ZU. While my previous video focused on the steam engine, this video covers the enormous generator that is driven by it. Are you ready to discover the brilliant electrical engineering in a time long before the first transistor was invented? Let's go full steam ahead! While I shall leave most of the history of this place to the previous video, let me quickly recap that this facility used to be part of a large factory producing town gas. Since the factory needed to operate 24/7 and was a crucial service to Zurich, a power outage would cause a lot of damage. Therefore, three of these steam engine generators were stationed here, in the middle of the factory, producing electrical power from coal, an abundant resource in a coal gas plant. They had the difficult job to keep the choice coming, no matter what. But generating electricity is simple, right? In school, they taught us that you can simply wrap an insulated copper wire around a core to make a coil. Then just make a magnet rotate inside that coil, and it will shove the electrons in the copper wire back and forth. Connect the wire's ends to a load, and you end up with alternating current, or AC. When measuring the voltage between the two wires, we observe that it oscillates back and forth, forming a sine wave corresponding to the rotation of the magnet. We thus have effectively created a simplistic AC generator. Time to name our parts. Since the magnet is rotating, we will call that part of the generator the rotor, and the surrounding coil, which is stationary, is thus called the stator. But we are not done here. Switzerland's power grid has, like many others, three-phase current. This means that you simply take three times what we have already, with the sine wave shifted by a third for each. To adapt our generator, we install three coils instead of one. Now, since the coils are all powered by the same rotor and their electric signal is thus coupled, we can tie one of their ends together, allowing our generator to have 3 plus 1 output wires instead of 6. The common end is called the neutral, and the three other ends are called the three phases, L1, L2 and L3. If we were to connect a multimeter between any two of those phases, the display would read 400 volts. If, however, we connect it between the neutral wire and any of the phases, we get 230 volts, which is what is delivered to the Swiss homes, meaning that one of these holes is connected to neutral and the other to one of the three phases. With that in mind, let's return to our steam-driven generator. We will tackle the stator first, which, just like in the example, houses the three coils, each providing a single phase. The coils are made out of copper and are electrically insulated from each other. Unfortunately, they're all painted black, so let's bring in some color, shall we? Painting the first phase in red, we see that it follows the stator in a zigzag pattern, surrounding it once completely. However, it doesn't stop there, but comes back for yet another round. The two other phases are doing just the same, but slightly offset each, giving the characteristical triple sine wave of three-phase current that we seek. The beginning and the end of each phase are located down here below. Four wires connect to them, one being the shared neutral and the other three being the three conductors. If you were to connect a modern lamp between any two of the three phases, it will work perfectly. If you were listening carefully before, you will notice that this isn't quite how Switzerland's actual power grid works. There, we had 230 volts between a face and a neutral. Here, we have 220 volts between two faces. Still, the frequency matches and the voltage is just 10 volts apart, so most modern appliances would work when connected between two of these faces. Moving on to the rotor. In our example, we had used a simple permanent magnet, but in addition to lacking the ability to be regulated, those were too weak at the time and would still be way too expensive to build into a generator of this size. Luckily, we can use another electrical trick from school. Wrap a wire around a core, run DC power through it, and you have an electromagnet. For now, let's ignore where that DC power comes from and instead just observe the coils. As you can tell from the interconnections between them, each coil is wired in reverse to the other, causing them to be of opposite polarity each. So unlike our little permanent magnet, this rotor here has a multitude of north and south poles when powered with DC. When it is at speed, it rotates such that at any given point in the stator, 100 poles pass by every second. Since they're alternating between north and south pole, this equals 50 Hz, which is the frequency of Switzerland's power grid. A big advantage of the rotor's poles consisting of electromagnets instead of permanent ones is that their power can be regulated. When running more DC power through the poles, their magnetic field becomes stronger and the AC generator thus produces a higher voltage. This way, the much smaller DC current can be used to control the much larger AC output of the generator. But where is that DC power coming from? You have probably guessed it. It's produced by a second smaller generator located on the same shaft. In this generator, the role of the stator and the rotor are flipped. The stator contains the magnets and the rotor has the coil. As the coil rotates in the magnetic field, an AC current is induced in it. Yes, that's right, AC, but we need DC here. To achieve this, we have to flip the rotor's polarity whenever the current changes direction. This is done by this commutator, with a brush picking up the electricity on top and another on the bottom. Since the commutator rotates with the shaft but the brushes don't, the physical rotation cancels out the alternating of the current and thus the brushes finally pick up DC. For a cool animation about this, check out the video of Anyway, the link is here. Unlike the model in that video, our rotor here has many coils and thus the commutator has many more poles than just two of them. This makes the generator produce a stronger and smoother output, but the principle is the same as in the model. With the DC generator's rotor covered, let's look at its stator. And there things get interesting, because it is yet another electromagnet. And in this case, the generator feeds on itself, taking a fraction of its own DC output to magnetize the stator's poles, inducing a current in the rotor producing more DC. Within this loop is a variable resistor that the operator controls to regulate the current flowing into the DC generator's poles. But now we have a bootstrapping problem. If the generator is off, how do we feed it DC to make it produce more DC to make the big generator produce AC? Turns out, the DC generator's poles are not entirely electromagnetic. Their iron is pre-magnetized, making them also be permanent magnets. Those are very weak, but the induced current is enough to produce a small amount of DC, which then fed to the poles for self-amplification. To bring everything together, this is how this crazy setup is started up. First, water is heated up to create pressured steam. Then, the steam engine is ramped up to its full speed. This causes both rotors to spin, and thus a small current is induced in the DC generator's rotor by the weak magnetic field of its stator's poles. This DC current is then directed to those very same poles, amplifying the magnetic field and producing a larger DC current in the rotor. This current is then sent through this slip ring to the AC generator's rotor, waking it up, so to speak, and generating three-phase AC current that can then be sent to the factory's power grid. The operator can adjust the before-mentioned variable resistor to change the DC generator's own DC input, regulating the AC generator's DC input, regulating the final output. Due to all of these extra steps, the AC generator's electric field takes a few seconds to build up. Once it does, it produces an intriguing howling sound. Listen carefully as Walters turns on the field, then takes it back down. While the system used to power huge electric machines, nowadays it is a witness of the past in this extraordinary little museum. For demonstration purposes, TGVZU has hooked the machine up to 6 halogen lamps that illuminate the whole assembly with its own electricity. However, that is way too little load for the powerful generator, and thus most of the load comes from an additional resistor that the team had installed to keep their electric mini-grid stable. And now you know the whole story, all the way from the heat to the watts. I hope this wasn't too much taking in. Let me know your thoughts in the comments. Again, a huge thank you to the TGVZU and in particular to Walters, who has been very patient with me. And of course, thank you very much my Patreons, who support my independent work. If you want to become one of them, check out the link in the description. And with that, well, thanks for watching and have a very nice day. Bye bye.